This Week at NASA. At the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan, Expedition 31 Soyuz Commander Gennady Padalka, NASA Flight Engineer Joe Acaba, and Flight Engineer Sergei Revin continued their preparations for their upcoming launch to the International Space Station. The crew conducted suited fit checks and reviewed procedures in the Soyuz capsule they'll take to the orbiting laboratory. The trio is scheduled to begin its journey May 15th, local time. SpaceX continues its preparations for the launch of Falcon 9 at Florida's Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. The Falcon 9 rocket will send aloft the unmanned Dragon spacecraft to the International Space Station, where it will be grappled remotely by the Expedition 31 crew. The SpaceX mission, now scheduled to launch on the morning of May 19th, will be the first commercial venture to the ISS. Administrator Charlie Bolden headed a delegation of senior NASA leadership that met with Japanese Prime Minister Yoshihiko Noda to discuss international cooperation in space. Presented by Bolden with a montage of mementos flown on STS-135, the final space shuttle mission, Prime Minister Noda said he wants to excite young people about careers exploring space, noting his envy of the five meeting attendees who'd actually done that.
Which is also telling us something fundamental.
The first global analysis by the Dawn spacecraft of Vesta has uncovered some interesting new findings about the giant asteroid.
We now know that Vesta is the only intact layered planetary building block surviving from the very earliest days of the solar system. Vesta exhibits many characteristics that define it more as a body that is transitional between asteroids and planets than being more like your garden variety asteroid. Vesta is special because it survived the intense collisional environment of the main asteroid belt for billions of years, allowing us to interrogate a key witness to the events at the very beginning of the solar system.
Dawn has also confirmed that a certain class of meteorites found here on Earth originally came from Vesta, making Dawn the first reverse sample return mission in space exploration history. NASA's Solar Dynamics Observatory captured these photos of a powerfully active region of the Sun called 1476 that's more than 60,000 miles across. This so-called monster sunspot has released multiple large flares. Sunspots occur where the magnetic field lines emerge from the inside of the Sun to form expanding loops above its surface. They appear dark because temperatures are considerably lower than in surrounding areas. SDO is the first launch mission in NASA's Living with a Star program, designed to understand the causes of solar variability and its impacts on Earth.
Say about the innovative process and government's role in it.
That's a great way to frame the problem because I think that's exactly the question.
NASA Chief Technologist Mason Peck offered his take on the role of research and development in revitalizing the nation's economic future in a special innovation summit held at Washington's Reagan National Airport. Sponsored by the Atlantic Monthly magazine, Peck's panel discussed how investment in American R&D and manufacturing benefits our economy.
When you pose difficult problems, such as sending humans to Mars, which is on NASA's plate right now, when you pose those kinds of problems and you put American industry to work and academia to work on those problems, you get innovation.
Researchers with the Mars Science Laboratory project at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory recently took science journalists on a two-day field trip and workshop to California's Mojave Desert.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Isn't it great?
The journalists were shown sedimentary rock exposures that, like those the Curiosity rover will study on Mars, reveal to scientists the history of their environment.
The hard part is how to extract the information from the rocks. So that's what everybody's learning to do here, is how to make measurements. We measure the thickness of the beds. We measure their grain size. We look at their mineralogy as best as we can understand it. And we record all of this information. And then from that, it will eventually allow us to reconstruct what kind of environment was here.
Lift off of the Atlas V with Curiosity, seeking clues to the planetary puzzle about life on Mars.
The MSL spacecraft carrying Curiosity was launched November 26, 2011, and is scheduled for an August landing on Mars at a site known as Gale Crater. A full-scale test version of NASA's Orion spacecraft has arrived at the Virginia Air and Space Center in Hampton, where it'll be on display through the summer. The 18,000-pound test vehicle built at the nearby Langley Research Center was used in the successful pad abort test of Orion's launch abort system in May 2010. NASA's first spacebound Orion capsule will undergo an uncrewed exploration flight test 1, planned for 2014. EFT-1 will see Orion travel farther into space than any human-rated spacecraft has gone in more than 40 years.
Recently, a team of scientists and volunteers from NASA Ames Research Center searched for debris left in the wake of a large meteor that plummeted into Northern California on April 22, 2012. To expedite their search, researchers enlisted the services of an airship called Eureka for an airborne survey of the debris field. During a five-hour flight, they searched a 300-square-mile area. They used a sophisticated video camera system that is commonly used to cover sporting events. Researchers were also conducting ground surveys to look for fragments. Within days, a NASA team was able to find and identify a fragment as a type of meteorite known as carbonaceous chondrite.
It is a really special meteorite because this particular one contains the all the goodies that scientists are interested in, the amino acids, all the compounds that could have made life possible on our planet.
Because meteorite fragments will quickly degrade when exposed to the elements, the rush to find them as soon as possible began. One of the larger fragments was discovered in the De Haas family pasture.
I'm glad you found it there. I'm glad it's a piece that's going to be valuable to science, and I'm looking forward to hearing some of the results from it.
Along with the De Haas fragment, over 20 specimens have been recovered. Some of the largest are now undergoing tests in a lab at Ames Research Center. This discovery could provide clues as to what our planet may have been made from and how life could have begun on Earth.
About 50 followers of NASA's social media websites got an up-close and personal, behind-the-scenes look at NASA's Dryden Flight Research Center during a NASA social on May 4th. The social media visitors, along with several news media representatives, were briefed on what Dryden is and does by center management, project engineers, and technicians.
Well, we're responsible for that collision avoidance stewardship throughout aviation.
They also toured various facilities, viewed research and support aircraft, had their photos taken in the cockpit of a NASA FA-18, and were even regaled by a low-level flyover and a sonic boom that occurred during a scheduled research mission support flight. The NASA social attendees responded by posting hundreds of tweets and comments about their experience on their Twitter, Facebook, and Google Plus accounts.
National Take Our Children to Work Day was upbeat and full of energy for students and children of Marshall Space Flight Center employees.
All right, now as you can see, he's filling the rocket with air pressure.
That's the action. All the pressure built, then there should be a... There it goes. Liftoff is reaction.
Performers in the educational show, FMA Live, brought Sir Isaac Newton's laws of motion to life for the potential future scientists and engineers. FMA Live, created by NASA and Honeywell International, is an award-winning traveling hip-hop science program designed to inspire elementary and middle school students to pursue studies in science, technology, engineering, and math by using interactive demonstrations in an entertaining way.
I'm Alan Chen. I'm the operations lead on the Intercept and Landing team for the Mars Science Laboratory project. Right now, I'm coordinating our preparations for entry, descent, and landing. We land in August, a few months from now, and we're still hurrying to get all our stuff ready to make sure that we're ready to take the plunge. I'll be telling people exactly what the spacecraft is doing, you know, roughly where it is, and what it's telling us is going on during EDL. My parents always displayed an example that education never stops. You always want to learn as much as you can, and it doesn't stop when you leave the classroom. My parents added new skills while I was still in high school, and you know, they got other degrees, and a lot of the times it was just for fun. We have essentially a copy of the spacecraft over in a different building here, where we can try to get this virtual spacecraft to run through the motions it will go through during EDL. We run trajectory simulations to understand its performance. We've probably literally run millions of simulated cases from crew stage operation all the way to the ground to make sure we get where we're going. You gotta work hard. There's a lot of academics that you need to get to this point in your career. Beyond that, I would also emphasize that it's not just about science and math, per se. If you can't talk about what you're doing, you're not going to get very far in this. You're going to have to convince people. This is a type of mission and a type of project and a type of thing that we do here that no one person can do by themselves. So you got to work with a lot of people. And learning how to work with those people is just as important as learning those basics in science and math. That's kind of the starting point. But to grow beyond that, you need to be able to work with people. There's a kind of exploration that we do here that can't be done anywhere else. There's certainly other places where you're doing things to make money, or you're doing things related to exploration. But here, the entire point of the place is about exploration. So I think I finally came to that realization sometime in late high school or early college that this is the type of place I want to be at.
3, 2, 1. We have booster ignition and liftoff of this space shuttle Atlantis, maintaining America's constant presence in space.
15 years ago, on May 15, 1997, Space Shuttle Atlantis launched from the Kennedy Space Center on STS-84. The mission was the sixth shuttle docking to the Russian Mir space station, exchanging astronaut Mike Foll for U.S. crew member Jerry Leninger, who'd spent 123 days there. Rounding out the Atlantis crew were Commander Charlie Precourt, a 2012 inductee into the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame, pilot Eileen Collins, and mission specialists Carlos Noriega, Ed Lu, Jean-Francois Clairvoy of the European Space Agency, and Elena Kondakova of Russia.
Go from start.
And May 16th marks the one-year anniversary of the launch of STS-134.
0 and liftoff for the final launch of Endeavour.
NASA's youngest shuttle lifted off from the Kennedy Space Center at 8:56 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time to the International Space Station, carrying with it the six-person crew of Commander Mark Kelly, pilot Greg Johnson, and mission specialists Mike Fink, Drew Feustel, Greg Shamatov, and Roberto Vittori of the European Space Agency. The 14-day mission delivered the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer, the Express Logistics Carrier 3, a high-pressure gas tank, and spare parts for other station hardware. STS-134 was the 36th and next-to-last shuttle mission to the International Space Station. And that's This Week at NASA. For more on these and other stories, or to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and other social media, log on to www.nasa.gov.